Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I start with an apology. This lecture was arranged in such a way that we used the upper floor with a projector so that people can see what we're doing at lunch. But because of the size of the people who are attending this, so the first floor couldn't accommodate. So we're having this lecture here. So please bear with me and bear with the university. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, the choice of the topic of this inaugural lecture was necessitated by the memo from President Muhammad Buhari to Funde Fala, Executive Chairman of the Federal Inland Revenue Service, on August 18, 2019, asking him to explain the shortfall in tax collected by his agency. Fala was asked to justify the obvious differences between the budgeted tax collections and actual collections for the period 2015 to 2018. The letter to Fowler signed by Chief of Staff to the President, Abakari Riz, and I quote, "Your attached letter, reference so, dated 29 July 2019, on the whole subject matter referred. We perceive significant variances between the budgeted collections and actual collections for the period 2015 to 2018. Accordingly, you are kindly invited to present an all-inclusive variance analysis explaining the reason for the variance between budgeted and actual collections for each main tax item for each of the years 2015 to 2018. In addition, we perceive that the actual collection for the period 2015 to 2017 were drastically worse than what was collected between 2012 and 2014. Accordingly, you are kindly to give details for the poor collections. You are invited to report by 19 August 2019. Please accept the assurances of my highest regards. The Chairman of the Federal Inland Revenue Service, FIRS, Mr. Tunde Fowler, has since responded to the query, agreeing that actual tax collection since the inception of President Muhammad Buhari administration was lower than the 2012 to 2014 period under former President Goodluck Jonathan, in general terms. Fowler noted, however, that the FIRS under his watch had performed better concerning particular non-oil tax staff, such as value-added tax, VAT, and corporate income tax, CIT. He, however, associated the shortfall since 2015 to the oil market prices, which has seen a fall in commodity prices compared to the period under Jonathan, and recession, which slowed down economic activity. Ladies and gentlemen, without going into what some people have alleged the political undertones in the web issued to the Executive Chairman, Federal Inland Revenue, it is fair to say that the President is highly frustrated, and rightly so, with the current situation where tax revenue in Nigeria accounts for a paltry 5% of the country's GDP, against the West African regional average of 15%, Asian average of 22%, and OECD average of 27%. The query to the Chairman of FIRS is a welcome call to the Apex Tax Authority that the government cannot afford to provide any meaningful development to the Nigerian people with tax-to-GDP ratio of 5%, for that matter. Anything below the regional average of 15% Perhaps to situate this lecture in a proper context, it is considered proper to begin from the beginning. In other words, what really is tax? And why does tax matter so much to the country's economic development to the point that the president will issue an open query to the country's chief tax collector to express his frustration with the low tax collection? This lecture therefore deals with one, the nature of tax, B, characteristics of a good tax system, C, gross domestic product, GDP, and taxation, 4, tax evasion and tax avoidance, D, why we pay tax and what does tax do, F, tax revenue GDP ratio, G, challenges to Nigerian tax system, H, the way forward. In conclusion, so starting with the nature of tax, tax is like a story a friend of mine in this audience told me once about somebody who misappropriated church money, Egonioka, somewhere around here, and disappeared to the north, somewhere in the north. One day he went to the market to buy yam. And when he was asking the Hausa man the price of yam, the Hausa man said, Kanaduka. So the man said to himself, how did this Hausa man know that I misappropriated Egonioka in my place? So he disappeared. When he went home, it was after days later that somebody explained to him that it was not Egonioka. The Hausa man actually meant, was he pricing the, yeah. So that's what tax looks like. Some years back, this part of Southeast, there's one particular state. If you wanted to frighten anybody from that place, and it's in a bus, all that you say, where is your tax receipt? And he will hit the roof and attempt to escape from the place. They are not alone. We all have tax. Once we talk about tax, people become jittery. They react in all kinds of ways. Unfortunately, though, tax is like death. At one point in time, you must pay. It is an enemy you cannot afford to hate. So we have to bear that in mind. When I teach tax in class, and some students say they don't earn income, so they won't pay tax, I laugh. Because if you go to the law and look at the law, once you're 18, it says income derived, brought into, and accrued. The lawyers here know what I'm talking about. So they try to tie you any income, even if it's a gift. Even the money your mom gives you is an income you earn. So it's taxable. So I come back there. First of all, let's all define tax. Tax, unfortunately, is defined from different angles. It depends on where you're looking at it. You can define it from the legal angle, from political angle, from economic angle, from accounting angle. But whatever happens, there are commonalities. There are certain characteristics that score these definitions. So one of the definitions is from Black's Law Dictionary. It says, tax has been given various definitions by individuals. Although there exist some common basic elements in them, Black's Law defines tax as a charge by the government on the income of an individual, corporation, or trust, as well as the value of an estate or gift. Whereas the dictionary defines, says, or opposite tax, that it says that tax is a charge or burden, usually pecuniary, led upon persons or property, yeah, for public purpose. Another definition is for national tax policy. It says tax according to the national policy for Nigeria is a monetary charge on a person's or entity's income, property or transaction, and is usually collected by a defined authority, which can be federal government, state government, or local government. Explicit in these definitions are, one, tax is an imposition. It's not optional. Two, tax is imposed by government. That's a legitimate authority. Three, tax is a charge on income. Four, tax is imposed to generate revenue by the government. In view of the above, tax is the legal mandatory extraction of money by government or public authority from the income of individual citizens for the purpose of meeting the needs of government in providing the needs of the people. Now let's talk about the characteristics of tax. Yeah, characteristics of a good tax system. One is that the tax system has to be fair and equitable. In terms of equity, we talk about horizontal and vertical equity. Then tax has to be adequate. Yeah, government has to collect enough money in order to run its services. Tax has to be transparent. Tax has to be simple. Simple for the taxpayer to understand, simple for the tax administrators to administer. And then tax has to have administrative ease. Let's talk about GDP so that we'll see the linkage. GDP is the market value of all goods and services produced within a country in a given period. It measures the net output or value added as it measures goods and services bought with money. Those of you in economics at elementary level and so on, you'll be familiar with this. There's a linkage between GDP and tax revenue. Ablaze and Dangogo, 2018, noted that there are numerous studies which examine the correlation between tax revenue and economic growth of Nigeria. Some of the studies, Arabita & Co., included oil tax revenue, while others, Tuta & Co., included all the revenue, all the taxes. Tax is an agent of economic growth, as it is used in finding many potential growth activities and other economic management. Thus, there is the concept of tax to GDP ratio, which is the ratio of a nation's tax revenue to its GDP. The tax to GDP ratio is used with other metrics to measure how much a nation's government controls its economic resources. Since tax is related to economic activities, the ratio should be relatively consistent. In Nigeria, this one report by FIRS, that is Federal Land Revenue Service, of increase in tax collection, yet tax GDP ratio has continued to exist unacceptably at 5%, 6%. Tax to GDP ratio is one of the most widely used tools for measuring the efficiency of a nation's tax system. As a result, one can depend on that to describe the level of tax system in Nigeria as poor. This is worrisome as tax is closely related to economic growth. When tax grows faster than GDP, tax to GDP ratio drops. But when at lower rate than GDP, the reverse is the case. The ratio of tax to GDP remains consistent as tax is closely related to level of economic activity. Now, let me say something that concerns each and every one of us, and that is tax evasion and tax avoidance. There's a difference between the two. Tax evasion is a deliberate or preconceived act or design on the part of a taxpayer to decrease tax burden. Is this a criminal offense, which in addition to fines and penalties may lead to imprisonment? Examples of tax evasion. I quote Basi here, who leads the list to include omitting or understating income liable to tax. So if you understate your income liable to tax, then you have committed tax evasion. Overstating expenses so as to reduce taxable income. Claiming relief and allowances which we do not merit. Failure to pay tax due or failure to remit withholding tax. Again, many of us here, especially institutions, are guilty of not remitting the withholding tax they got from salaries they pay to staff. And if we are not to follow the letters of the law, what happens? We are guilty of a tax evasion. At worst, I mean at best, you have to pay. At worst, you have to pay and equally go to prison. Apart from institutions, everybody here, including myself, if I ask you, have you filed your tax return for this year? Yeah, the answer will be no. Which means all of us are guilty of tax evasion. On the other hand, you have what we call tax avoidance. Tax avoidance is a situation where you use the loopholes in the law to perhaps mitigate the burden of your tax. So where the law gives options, so you can take that option which gives you an advantage. It is important for you to know this. There are examples, but for me, the difference between tax evasion and tax avoidance is very, very severe. You do not know when, you may not know when to cross the border. Because aggressive tax avoidance may lead to tax evasion with serious consequences. Now, the next thing is, why do we pay tax? That's what you ask yourself. Why should I pay tax? There are three things. One, the Bible. Two is the law. Three, the social contract, physical contract between the governed and the gods, and the governors. So I say here, without trying to cause controversy, I must say that the issue of tax and its payment is as old as mankind. In Genesis chapter 14, verses 17 to 20, the reference you may permit me to quote. Abraham paid some tax, that's tax, to Melchizedek, king of Salem. Even in Jesus' time, payment of tax was right, and Jesus approved of the payment by directing Peter to pay for their obligation which are falling due at the time. This event shows that right from creation till now, tax matters so much. The physical social contract between citizens and elected implies that citizens should pay tax which the leaders will utilize to execute programs for the collective good. We also pay tax because it is a legal requirement. As a failure to pay will be punishable by law, thus there is a biblical injunction, legal requirement, and fiscal social responsibility requirement, making it obligatory for you to pay tax. However, people talk about them, complain about them, and try to dodge them when they can. Businesses also react to taxes both in how they put together their activities and perhaps in where they execute their business. How persons and businesses react in turn affects the canon and the organization of taxation. We must quickly point out that the tax refers to a compulsory levy by a public authority for which nothing is received directly in turn. That's absence of pre-approval. That's no question of the rub my back, I rub your back. Objectives of taxation. In agreement with the view of Mother and Co., major objectives of taxation comprise the following. Revenue generation. The government raises tax in order to raise revenue, to provide the infrastructure facilities, those somebody call public goods. Government also uses tax to redistribute income, what you call redistribution of income, in fact. The management of the economy. You know, when there is a boom, and government wants to control, what it does is to perhaps raise the tax rate. So the amount of income, what you call spendable income in your hand, will be smaller. On the other hand, when government wants to boost the economy, you reduce it and reduce the rate of tax so that you have more spendable money. So government does that to manage the economy. Again, use the tax for economic development. Use tax to provide full employment and control of fluctuations. Reduction of balance of payment and then price stability. Now let me talk a little bit about tax to GDP ratio before I go to the main problem. Tax to GDP ratio is a ratio of a nation's revenue relative to its gross domestic product, or the market value of goods and services in a country, which a country produces. Unfortunately, the slide is not here, and some of you don't have the documents I'm referring to. But then, when you get this paper, I have tables 1 to 4 that actually detail the collection, tax collections and revenue of 15 countries. 15 several countries and 15, I'll say, advanced economies. And I compared their tax to GDP ratio with that of Nigeria. The one with the lowest GDP, we have begin, and Nigeria has a prestigious, prestigious position of being three. And then for the top rated countries, we had no place there. The other figures here and tables have shown that Nigeria, for a very, very long time, tax to GDP ratio has remained between 5 and 6. Kind of stagnation. Now, the World Bank and IMF have said that for any country to develop meaningfully, it should have a minimum of 15% tax to GDP ratio. So Nigeria at the moment has 6%. So you tell me, if nothing drastic is done, how do we get there? So let me go straight to challenges to the Nigerian tax system. The following challenges increasing the tax-GDP ratio are common to all developing African countries, Nigeria inclusive. One, generally the objectives of a good tax system such as economic efficiency, effectiveness and equitability frequently conflict. In addition, progressive taxes in highly unequal societies, including Nigeria, are difficult to achieve. Two, Patella 2018 reports that up to 80% of the workforce in African countries are outside the formal sector. Even though taxation can be carved out in several ways, one of the most important components of tax system is income tax, which is deducted from wages and salaries. That's why you can't invest. Once you work, they deduct the tax at source. Whether they remit it to inland revenue or not, it's another matter. Because it's like somebody owing you, which is an offense, and you going outside to, what do you do? You want to force the person to pay the tax, holding it by the neck. That is a public assault. So there are two different things. Number three, there is hardly any taxation in Africa. It seems to be our main source of income. Although there are improvements in the tax system, such as the simplification of the tax system, improved tax administration at the central government level, and improved attitudes and administration towards some segments of taxpayers, tax reforms are hardly on the policy agenda of Nigerian and other African countries. One of the major factors contributing to low tax revenue and consequently low tax to GDP ratio is inefficient administration. The problem of tax administration is systemic. One of the major problems is fiscal federalism. What do we mean here? We have three tiers of government, federal, state, and local government. Sometimes you don't know which of the organs collects the tax. Yeah. And then a taxpayer can hide under that to escape paying taxes. Another problem is the fiscal issue is the problem of multiple taxation, which subjects the tax base to more than two or three taxes. Then you have the issue of corruption. Corruption in the tax system. The corruption in the tax system is tripartite. One is corruption by the taxpayers, where correct tax amounts are not declared. Thus, lower taxes are paid to the relevant tax authorities. The second is the corruption on the part of the tax authorities, where tax collectors connive with the taxpayers to shortchange the government. This usually happens with the taxpayer being issued a clean tax clearance certificate when you shouldn't have had it. The third is on the part of the government where the revenue generated from the tax revenue is not utilized to the benefit of the taxpayer as they are stolen from the government first. I don't want to be political, but I think I remember the snake and 20-something billion case where a strange snake swallowed so much. We already have reports of missing money here and there. Remember that this money is your tax. Yeah, it's your tax. That's what I often say to some of the security agents when they see you on the road and then they point their gun at you. I say, why do you do that, man? This gun you have is from my tax. This uniform you're wearing is from my tax. You are paid to protect me, so why do you want to kill me? So this money, they said, whether X, Mr. Appropriated or Mr. Y, is your own tax. Government is not that using that money for your own good. And yet under the fiscal contract agreement, the government is supposed to use that money to provide for your own government. So sometimes you need to ask questions. Therefore, you have revenue shock arising from trade liberalization. Economists have long considered trade liberalization as a common, essential component of growth and development. As increased trade and capital flows spur growth, the loss in trade tax revenue is expected to be easily replaced with the taxes collected from a more dynamic private sector. Consequently, trade liberalization in the developing world was accepted as a necessary step in the path to development success. However, this rosy view notwithstanding, many developing countries have been facing formidable challenges, recovering from the revenue shock and substituting their lost trade tax revenue with domestic taxes. The end result is that liberalizing trade has translated into a large and rapid loss of trade tax revenue for the government. A large percentage of citizens in poor economies are logistically difficult to tap. What am I saying here? I don't want to mention the name, but sometime a friend here took me to a spot in Enugu to eat. And as a researcher, we queued up and I was counting the number of people who were going and at the stage. Within the period we were, we had over 50 people under 30 minutes. And I did a quick mathematics. I said, assuming everybody spent 1,000 here, under 5 minutes, they would have spent 50,000. And this is something that goes on every day. Do they pay tax? If they pay, how much do they pay? But think of a level 6 officer you employ here. You can ask your boss to tell the audience how much tax that officer pays. And that reminds me of the story my co-chancellor told me yesterday about his tax bill. The tax bill in the US is something you cannot avoid. Yes? You either pay or go to jail. So you have to pay. Yeah. Now, you will have weak bureaucracies in terms of staff and obsolete technologies in collecting taxes. Yeah? How do we do that? We still just security. Security has two arms. One intelligent and the other one is deposit. Yeah? These days, you find out that the intelligent aspect is more effective than the force. Yeah? Because if you are a tax collector, as soon as they see you and you are tax man, what do? They take to their head. Yeah. I remember when they made me a fellow of the Chartered Institute of Taxation, and we were struggling to collect the batch. And somebody said to me, man, you know what you're collecting? I said, of course, a batch of fellowship batch. He said, man, you don't really know the burden you're going to put on. So then he told me a story of an embarrassing story. He wore the batch and was in a public transport. Yeah. And the people who were sitting with him gave him a distance. Why? Because I thought he was a tax collector. So anytime you talk about tax, people just look at you, right? Yeah. So, we have equally tax reforms. Yeah? We don't engage in tax reforms as frequently as we should. Then, taxation is low in our political agenda. Why? Something happened around. You know, politicians, when it's time for election, they promise you heaven and earth. No tax, your businesses will flourish and so on and so forth. But as soon as you give them a clean bill of a comeback. So, it's always difficult, especially in Nigeria, where we go for second tenure or third tenure. In your first tenure, you try as much as possible not to offend the people so that you can go for second tenure. However, when it comes to the third tenure, you can decide to charge anything.
Yeah.
Most of them, the political, economic elite are not part of our tax system. You ask yourself here, like the question I asked the vice chancellor, many of us know how much we earn, directly or indirectly. If you compare it with what a civil servant pays, you will know that their lives are not there. Our tax bases are astronomically very low. Yeah. The tax base where the government uses to charge tax. So that the same people keep paying the government this money, it goes to the same people. So the tax base is very narrow. As a matter of fact, one of the major causes of the low tax rate revenue to GDP in Nigeria is low tax base. Out of estimated 200 million people in Nigeria, the World Bank put the economically active population at 65%. I mean 65 million. Out of this 65 million, the federal government recently claimed to have increased the taxpayer population from 10 million to 20 million. This puts the percentage of active taxpayers to 31%. This implies lack of efficiency in tax administration in bringing reasonable number of payers into the tax bracket. As noted by Oladipo and Ogechukwu 2019, this results to pressure on the active taxpayers as government will tax them more in order to meet its obligation. Massive revenue from natural resources and natural resources are lost. Illicit capital flows, which are facilitated by tax havens, entrench the inefficient tax system.
You know, in this part of in this world, you have what we call tax havens.
Yeah? These are countries that either they charge no tax at all, or they charge very low tax. And what some of these multinationals and ourselves do is to transfer our income to that level, so that we pay less tax. So that's one of the things responsible for poor tax collection. Then we have poor taxation of the informal sector. As noted in IMF working paper on informal sector economy in Sub-Saharan Africa, it is estimated that the informal sector accounts for 50% to 65% of economic activity in Nigeria. The informal sector in Nigeria is estimated at 63%. Business in the informal sector hardly pay taxes or remit other taxes such as value-added tax and withholding tax to the relevant authority. Thus, there is a high level of tax leakage that will have significantly contributed to the revenue derived in the country. But if you have low tax education, the general literacy rate in the country is around 50%. The level of tax education is expected to be lower as tax issues are sometimes very complex. Many taxpayers do not know the various taxes they are expected to pay. And the businesses as well lack the professional knowledge on tax computation and the compliance. There is a high level of non-remittance of withholding tax in our tax system. You see, I said that again. Institutions, organizations, employers of labor deduct tax from PAYE. Now, the only people who pay are those who are outside the government sector. Yeah. Because if they don't pay, the government can come and lock up their business. But for those who are government agents, what do they do? They don't pay. This thing is in our family. What does that mean? The government gives them subvention to pay salaries and other things. And what happens? This government gives them less than what they are supposed to get. What do they do? They use the tax deducted to make up. But for those outside the government system, you cannot afford to do that. Now the time is now spent. Let's go to the issues. What do we do? Yeah, because one problem in Nigeria ask any Nigerian about the Nigerian problem, what does they do? You will analyze it so perfectly, but when it comes to preparing solution, then we have a problem. So my suggestion, the way forward. One, in addition to the suggested solution to the challenges identified, the government needs to take the following action. One, improving the existing tax system with a view to reducing inequalities through increasing progressiveness and by raising additional revenue through indirect taxes. C, focusing on tax reform that will simultaneously facilitate revenue growth, build administrative capacity, and build accountability. This is another problem. There is no accountability in our system. If you go through our laws, the government, the state government, the local government, the federal government, which of them actually publishes annual account? No. Sparingly, sometimes you just say either Edo State or Imo State, just to score a political point. After 6 months or so, they publish 1 month account, and that's it. Federal government, not anything they do is in time. So for you, for transparency to exist, you just take the account. And if you go there even to ask, they look at you twice. I once gave my students an assignment to go to local government to look at their revenue profile and so on. Only God knows what happens. So, making tax strong. Yeah, government should also take the following, improving our local government taxes. Again, as for say, most of us come from different local governments. Go to your local government chairman and ask him, what tax does they collect? Yeah. Because sometimes we mix tax with levy. Tax is different from levy. That's why they use, what do you call it, torch to block the roads, and then with the nails and the sticks, they punch your car. What tax does any local government collect? Virtually nothing. They live on whatever allocation federal government gives. But in advanced countries, developed countries, local governments have their own tax. Supporting civil society groups' capacity to engage with the state on tax issues. Yeah, I doubt if they will do that. Because if people go out to criticize government, and then they are locked up. So how much about the tax system? If you talk about the tax, then you are in jail or they give you higher tax. Making tax strong on the domestic political agenda. Carrying out tax informality surveys and surveys of tax perceptions to identify willingness to pay issues around inequality and social injustice. Establishing better links between taxes paid and service delivery. Again, this is a critical point. I remember years back, 1982, 83, I could drive from Onitsha to Enugu under 45 minutes from Onitsha, I would be at the 9th night. But tell me, those of you who travel every day from here to Onitsha, tell me how many hours you spend. And your government is supposed to use your tax to make the place faster. Problems. So for government actually to motivate people to do that, something has to be done. Government has to carry out people-friendly projects. Intensifying efforts to stop oil theft and illegal oil bunkering. Three, in addition, the Nigerian government should provide tax reform that will reduce tax exemptions and eliminate tax completely. Or eliminate them completely. Tackle capital flight aimed at evading taxation. Strengthen the administration of natural resources, taxation especially in extractive industries. Improve progressively through income tax and property taxes. Seek for more effective ways to tax the informal sector. In Ghana, what they do is to get the informal sector to form unions. Yes. And through the unions, they're able to identify what they get and then seek for more effective ways to tax the informal sector itself. Put in place a simplified tax regime for micro and informal sector. Establish
dedicated tax credit for small and medium enterprises in the country, improve local government taxation. Nigeria and other developing nations should urgently strive to replace almost a third of their already low tax revenue base with tax to collect domestic taxes. Effective use of tax clearance certificate for transactions. There is something the government started some years back called tax clearance certificate. In other words, if you want to purchase a firearm, if you want to land, if you want government contract, if you want to stand as a politician and so a political office holder, you produce what? Your tax clearance certificate. That forced people to go and get tax. But what did we get in effect? People started with producing tax there was a case of somebody who went to the American Embassy to obtain a visa, and they declared an income of 200 million. So the American Embassy looked at the tax, the African tax clearance certificate they have. So they come to the I said, I was no. It didn't cost us. So what did they do? Of course, they went back to the trenches and manufactured another. So I think if government actually can do it, we will still get a lot of revenue. So I think the rain is asking me to actually round up. But before I do that, Mr. Chairman, please help me to recognize the full council of Tansian University who has cited. So, Professor Akam, are you around here? Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, I know I saw some of your students and some of your... And then, the former Vice Chancellor of the Netherlands University, who is also coming from Tansian. I think I saw his... yeah, that's it, yeah. Thank you. Yeah, this lecture will not end. Okay. There is Honorable Mrs. Devon, is representing the Institute of Taxation of Nigeria. Yeah. You can be there to the governor of the Enugu State. Please and please, in all sincerity, I call you today. Forgive me. But I don't know. It's my wife here. Yeah? Oh, thank you very much. One of my enviable daughter. Is she there? Is she there? Okay, thank you very much. One of your husband. Vanessa. Okay, they're there. Well, those of you who are here, you should extend my thanks to your siblings who are separated from us because of the distance. They can't be here at this time. So thank you so much, Mr. Bartoszal. Let me now conclude. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I thank you so much for finding me proper and a proper person to deliver this lecture. I'm sure if I have bored you, you forgive me. That is the nation of a subject. A subject the government is afraid of. A subject the taxpayers are afraid of. A subject lecturers are afraid of the teacher. So who am I? The best was said, thank you.
Please put your hands together for our inaugural lecturer, Professor Eugene Nwadialor. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.